Hey, what's up? John Sonmez here, and today we're going to be continuing our series on moral letters to Lucilius. I did confirm the pronunciation of Lucilius. It is Lucilius, as I thought. It's not Lucilius. If we were Italian, it would be Lucilius, although it is Roman, so it does make you wonder a little bit. At least that's what dictionary.com says, and I'm going to stick with dictionary.com's pronunciation. If you are newly joining and you're like, wow, this is pretty fucking awesome, we're going to like go over Seneca's letters and talk about some Stoic shit and whatnot, what you want to do is, well, first of all, subscribe to the channel, of course, and hit the bell so that you get all the new videos, as I'm going to go through all of these letters and give you commentary on them. And then also check out the playlist here. So you can start from letter one and go through it all, and, you know, heck, by the time you're watching this, maybe they're all exist, and you can just go through all, like, 100 letters or 200 letters and just have a good old fun Stoic time. So, let's get into it here. In this letter, this one is number 4, on the terrors of death is what it's titled here. And it starts off with number 1, verse 1, keep on as you have begun and make all possible haste, so that you may have longer enjoyment of an improved mind, one that is at peace with itself. Doubtless you will derive enjoyment during the time when you are improving your mind and setting it at peace with itself. But quite different is the pleasure which comes from contemplation when one's mind is so cleansed from every stain that it shines. So kind of interesting here. You know, some of this, by the way, you know, I'm going to give you my best commentary, my best understanding of this, but some of the things I'm not going to have a perfect understanding of, but hopefully it'll be good enough to actually give you some value out of this. You're going to get some enjoyment out of, like, improving yourself, of learning, right? Improving your mind. You know, he says, keep on as you've begun, make all possible haste so that you have a longer enjoyment of an improved mind. So he's saying, like, learn quickly, okay? But here's the thing. You're going to get more enjoyment out of the contemplation, like the resting period of your mind. Basically says it's a quite different pleasure which comes from the contemplation when one's mind is so cleansed from every stain that it shines. So what he's saying here is that, is essentially, like, yes, keep on learning, keep on going the path that you're going, but at some point, you know, you're going to need to, like, contemplate. You're going to need to not, like, just constantly be seeking out knowledge. And you'll find this is a recurring theme in what Seneca says here, is because he's very big on, like, you crumbing up your own thoughts and your own philosophies in life, not just quoting other people, okay? So there's a little bit of that in there. Verse 2, he says, you remember, of course, what joy you felt when you laid aside the garments of boyhood and donned the man's toga and were escorted to the forum. Nevertheless, you may look for a still greater joy when you have laid aside the mind of boyhood and when wisdom has enrolled you among men. For it is not boyhood that still stays with us, but something worse, boyishness. And this condition is all the more serious because we possess the authority of old age, together with the follies of boyhood, yea, even the follies of infancy. Boys fear trifles, children fear shadows, we fear both. So he's basically talking about, and this is kind of interesting because, just in reading this, I realized that the problem that we have with society today, right? I did this video on the boys are not all right. You can check that out. And I talk about this a lot on this channel, of boys not becoming men, right? And he back in this day, back in the Roman day, in the fucking warriors and Spartan day, this was still the problem, right? This was still the problem, is that, you know, he's saying that you've gone through the thing, right? You've laid aside the garments of boyhood. You've been escorted into the forum. You're wearing the man's toga. Yet, but you still have the mind of boyhood, right? In all appearances, you're a man, but you still have the mind of a boy, right? Of boyishness is what he calls it. And even to some degree, infantileness, right? And so this is kind of one of the things is about being a Stoic and developing the Stoic philosophy, is hardening, is becoming that man, stepping into that, right? It's not just necessarily for men, right? Obviously, he's addressing this in a manliness type of viewpoint, but basically stepping into maturity, or adulthood, you could say, where you're leaving behind the, you know, the emotional dramas that you're going to have, right? You're becoming self-assured. You're becoming self-aware, right, to some degree, and not allowing yourself to be just just swept by the wind of chance, of fortune, right? So it's interesting, too. I like that he says that boys fear trifles, children fear shadows. We fear both, right? And so that's the thing, is he's saying that, like, this is our condition, right? And he's not excluding himself from that. He's saying that, you know, we've got this authority of old age, but we've got the follies of boyhood still, right? And so that's a bad combination. So how can we purge that out, right? This is something that's going to be a recurring theme here. Number three, all you need to do is to advance. You will thus understand that some things are less to be dreaded, precisely because they inspire us with great fear. No evil is great, which is the last evil of all. Death arrives, it would be a thing to dread if it could remain with you, but death must either not come at all, or else must come and pass away. So he's basically saying this, right? And this is where we get into the death part, the morbidity part. Is he saying this? Look, okay, so there's some things that are less, that you shouldn't dread as much, okay? it's partially because they give you great fear, right? And so he's saying, you know, the worst evil is the last one, right? It's death. And the thing is this, is that, like, death is not going to come, or if it comes, it's going to pass, right? So it's not going to stay with you, right? You know, I think, like, a genuine fear would be, like, being tortured forever, right? And that's actually kind of the fear that a lot of religion uses to kind of get you in line. It's like, oh, you're gonna be tormented forever. Okay, that's worse than death, right? So death itself is not something to fear, right? Because it doesn't matter, because it's not gonna stay with you, right? And there's some parts, you know, I think later on in some letters where he kind of philosophizes about this, like, well, you know, what happens after you die? I don't know. Like, it's either you're not gonna know, it doesn't matter, or, you know, or it's like, you know, or you're gonna live on. Either way, it doesn't matter, right? It's like he kind of comes to this point. He's not addressing it quite here yet, but it's something interesting, right, to consider this idea that it's going to pass, right? He says the same thing about pain, right? Pain is either, like, excruciatingly great and short in duration, or not that bad, but maybe it'll last a long time, right? Because if it's so excruciating, you're going to die from it, right? Number four, it is difficult, however, you say, to bring the mind to a point where it can scorn life. But do you not see what trifling reasons impel men to scorn life? One hangs himself before the door of his mistress. Another hurls himself from the housetop that he may no longer be compelled to bear the taunts of a bad-tempered master. A third, to be saved from arrest after running away, drives a sword into his vitals. Do you not suppose that virtue will be as efficacious as excessive fear? No man can have peaceful life who thinks too much about lengthening it, or believes that living through many councilships is a great blessing. So there's a lot here, right? It's kind of going a couple of different directions. But essentially what he's saying here is that, like, you know, do you see that, like, the stupid reasons why people, like, hate their lives, right? Why people are like, you know, today they would say, FML, fuck my life, right? And he's saying, like, you know, one of them is, like, because he's got this mistress, like, this is, like, his stupidity. Another one, he's got a bad-tempered master. Another one, like, you know, you've done some stupid crime, you did something stupid, and you're running away from the law, and you know. And so he's saying, like, these are just, like, stupid reasons. Like, you've created these problems yourself, so why are you scorning life because of that? It's just stupidity, okay? But then he goes on to talk about this idea that, like, you can't have peace in life if you think too much about lengthening it. And so this is a really good concept too. Is it's like, if you spend so much time trying to preserve your life, right, you're going to actually lose the essence of it, because you're not going to enjoy it, right? There was a really powerful quote from Tony Robbins that really rocked my world a while back. He said that the quality of your life is direct proportion to the amount of uncertainty you can comfortably live with. And when I digested and understood that, I realized that, like, all these things that I was doing to, like, keep myself safe, to, like, have comfort, to basically have security, and to have certainty, those were the things that were actually sucking the life out of life. Because when you don't when you do that, when you're carefully guarding your life to extend it or whatever it is, what you're doing is that, like, you're preventing yourself from actually experiencing life, right? And the joys, the ups and downs of life, because you're just trying to hold on to something. And so there's no point in trying to hold on to something that is not actually valuable, right? You could live into, you know, 120 years old, but if you're living your life in a guarded and cautious way, making sure that you never cross the road without looking, and, like, you know, I mean, obviously you should do that, but you see what I'm saying? Like, just being very, very, very careful and never having fun, well, it wouldn't be much of a life anyway. Okay, so he says, number five, rehearse this thought every day, that you may be able to depart from life contentedly. For many men clutch and cling to life, even as those who are carried down a rushing stream clutch and cling to briars and sharp rocks. Most men ebb and flow in wretchedness between the fear of death and the hardships of life. They're unwilling to live, and yet they do not know how to die. Very critical viewpoints of the Stoic philosophy here. This idea that, like, is what we just talked about. This idea that, okay, so you're not living, not really living your life, but you're afraid to die. So you're caught in the middle here, like just clinging on, holding on to life, like you're being swept down a stream. That's no way to live, right? You know, just fucking let's cruise down the river if we're going to cruise down the river, right? Or let's just go, right? Like, you're going to die, then die. Be happy, be contented to die. Like, live your life in such a way that if you pass, you're like, well, you know, I lived my life, right? As opposed to living your life in such a way that you're trying to hold on to it for dear life, right? But you're not actually, it's not actually worth anything. So, number six, he says, for this reason, make life as whole agreeable to yourself by banishing all worry about it. So don't fucking worry. Like, just fucking live, right? No good thing renders its possessor happy unless his mind is reconciled to the possibility of loss. Okay, I want to stop on that statement. No good thing renders its possessor happy unless his mind is reconciled to the possibility of loss. So if you haven't already... considered that you're going to lose something good and that you could and have let that go, right? Then you're not going to make, it's not going to be happy. Because look, here's the thing, right? I've not had money, I've had money, okay? I'm at a point where I'm willing, like, I mean, I obviously don't want to lose money, okay? I obviously don't want to lose, you know, things that I have and that I've built in my life, but I'm willing to. And I'm willing to let them go, and I've already reconciled that with myself. And the reason why is because if you've never had money and then you get money, your biggest fear every single fucking day will be you will lose it, okay? And so you'll be more miserable than when you didn't have money. I know a lot of people that, a lot of you might be saying, oh, yeah, that's bullshit, John. Well, you know what? It's not bullshit. Like, you can ask people who've experienced this, or you can look at kind of wealthy people that are unhappy with their life, and you'll see that the reason why is because they're trying to hold on to all this shit, right? It's really difficult. The bigger the pile is, the bigger the arms you have to have, and the more likely that someone is going to steal your shit, or you're going to have more stuff to lose. So you have to be contented with, or you have to reconcile the idea of loss first. As soon as you get something, count it loss, right? Count everything in your life as loss already and be happy, and then it'll be a bonus. It'll be an add. I like to say, it's all fucking gravy, right? If you consider everything in life to be all fucking gravy besides breathing fucking air and being above the ground, then your life will be much, much more agreeable to you. Okay, he says, also, no good thing, okay, we said that. Okay, nothing, however, is lost with less discomfort than that which, when lost, cannot be missed. So again, it's the exact same thing, right? You're not going to miss it because you've already reconciled it, it's not going to be any discomfort for you when you lose it, okay? Therefore, encourage and toughen your spirit against the mishaps that afflict even the most powerful, right? Core of Stoic philosophy. We're going to toughen ourselves up so that we can deal with this shit and it doesn't phase us, right? Shit doesn't phase us. That's Stoic philosophy. Shit doesn't phase us, right? It doesn't mean we don't feel emotions. It just means that shit doesn't phase us. We keep on marching, right? You feel the pain, you keep on walking, all right? Number seven, for example, the fate of Pompeii was settled by a boy and a eunuch, that of Crassus by a cruel and insolent Parthian. Now, again, I don't know all of the Roman history here, so I'm not going to be able to give you a lesson in this case, but, you know, he's writing this to Lucius, who presumably does. Gaius Caesar ordered Lepidus to bare his neck for the axe of the tribune, Dexter, and he himself offered his own throat to Chariah. No man has ever been so far advanced by fortune that she did not threaten him as greatly as she had previously indulged him. This is a really good quote here. No man has ever been so far advanced by fortune that she did not threaten him as gently as she had previously indulged him, right? So, here's the thing. Fortune gives you something, right? Fortune says, hey, you won the lottery of life. Here you go. Here's some money. Here's some girls. Here's some whatever it is, okay? Here's the thing, right? She's going to threaten you just as greatly as you've been indulged. So this is the whole concept of if you gain something, now you're going to fear losing it. Oh, ha 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 ha. Catch 22, motherfucker. You're going to fear losing it now. You see what you're going to feel losing it. You see what I'm saying? So the way out of this catch 22 is to not fear the loss. It's to already count it as lost. They were saying, hey, fortune gave it to me. Fortune take it away, right? A Stoic is a Buddhist who says, fuck you to fate. I like that. So that's kind of the idea here is, fuck you, fate. I'm not going to let you ruin my life or determine the course of my life. He says here, do not trust her seeming calm, speaking of fortune. In a moment, the sea is moved to its depths. The very day that ships have made a brave show in the games, they are engulfed. So, yeah, fortune gives you shit. Fortune will fuck you the very next day. So don't count on that, right? Don't just say, I'm lucky, all right? Number 8. Reflect that a highwayman or an enemy may cut your throat. And though he is not your master, every slave wields the power of life and death over you. So check this out, okay? You're walking down the street in New York City. Some gang member, hood rat, comes in and just like fucking for no reason stabs you, shoots you for your sneakers, okay? Happens, all right? Can happen. Some drunk, crazy person on drugs comes up and kills you because you made a rude comment to them or you looked at them funny. You're on the road, fucking road rage. You cut someone off, you didn't even mean to. They get out of the car, they have a shotgun, they shoot you. This shit happens, right? So he's basically saying, like, you can't control this shit. It doesn't matter how powerful you are. It doesn't matter if you're the master and they're the slave. The slave has the power to kill you, right? He's probably stronger than you. So don't think that you're so big and that you can just, quote, avoid death. It's not going to happen, right? Like, you are at risk at any given time. So just realize that this is the case. Doesn't mean live in fear, but it means understand this, okay? So he says, therefore, I declare to you, he is Lord of your life that scorns his own. So, okay, and this is really important. This is a really, really important thing. Maybe the most important thing to understand in this part of the text. He is Lord of your life that scores his own. What does this mean? It basically means this. If someone's willing to fuck themselves, they can fuck you. You see what I'm saying? If someone's willing to kill themselves, if they scorn their own life, they can take you down. So no matter how big you are, no matter how powerful or how mighty you are, one person in an automobile who says, my life's not worth living, can take you down. One person with a gun, with a knife, who has that viewpoint in their head, can take you down. So you gotta be careful. Like, you definitely don't want to take away hope and crush people's hopes. If you're a dream crusher, a hope crusher, it's a bad place to be, right? Because you're going to put yourself in, you never want to put someone in a position where you've made them scorn their life and they're going to take you out and you're not going to be able to do anything about it. People can kill you in your sleep. People can poison you, right? There's a lot of ways that if someone is not worried about going to prison or dying themselves, they can take you out. So it's something that you should always have in your mind whenever you're in interactions with people is that, look, how can I resolve this peacefully and make this person feel good, okay? Because you never know what kind of random shit is going to happen. It's good to, like, take that randomness out of your life as much as possible, okay? Think of those who have perished through plots in their own home, slain either openly or by guile. You will that just as many have been killed by angry slaves as by angry kings. What matter, therefore, how powerful he be whom you fear when everyone possesses the power which inspires your fear? I thought that's pretty brilliant, too. Like, how many people have been killed by angry slaves versus angry kings? Probably more by angry slaves, or at least the same amount, or at least a good number, right? So, you know, think about this. Worry about this a little bit, right? Everyone's got this power that you're fearing. So, again, it's kind of saying don't fear death. At the same time, it's saying also, you know, be magnanimous with people. And it's also saying that, that kind of like if you were willing to like go to a very far length, you can equalize. Like crazy people equalize power, right? Let's put it that way. People that have nothing to lose, okay? That's why we have suicide bombers and all this shit. Number 9. But you will say, if you should chance to fall into the hands of the enemy, the conqueror will command that you be led away. Okay? Yes, whether you are already being led. Why do you voluntarily deceive yourself and require to be told now for the first time what fate it is that you have long been laboring under? Take my word for it. Since the day you were born, you are being led thither. We must ponder this thought and thoughts of the like nature. If we desire to be calm as we await that last hour, the fear of which makes all previous hours uneasy. So I know this is a little bit complicated, but I'll break down what he's saying here. Essentially what he's saying is this, okay? He's basically saying that you are already being led to your death, right? That is the direction you're headed. I'm headed that direction, you're headed that direction. So, you know, what do you think? Like, are you going to be afraid? Are you going to realize that this is your fate, right? Like, there's no way. You've already been conquered. You're already a slave to death. You're already being led to your death, okay? That's like every day you get closer, right? I know this sounds like morbid thought, but you got to take this into hold so that you don't have to fear this at the last hour, like, that you can calmly await the last hour. This is another stoic principle, is this idea of like not fearing death, because you know it's coming, right? That's where you're going. You're headed there every day. So what, are you going to fear this your whole life, right? So are you going to make your whole, like, at least like fear the last hour when the sword is coming down, but don't like make your whole life just a fear of this thing that you know is coming, okay? Number 10, but I must end my letter. Let me share with you the saying which pleased me today. It too is culled from another man's garden. Poverty, brought into conformity with the law of nature, is great wealth. Do you know what limits the law of nature, what limits that the law of nature ordains for us? Merely to avert hunger, thirst, and cold. In order to banish hunger and thirst, it is not necessary for you to pay court at the doors of the purse proud, or to submit to the stern frown, or to the kindness that humiliates. Nor is it necessary for you to scour the seas or to go campaigning. Nature's needs are easily provided and ready to hand. So he's basically saying this, okay? Poverty, when you conform to nature, is great wealth. So it basically, like, it's not very hard for you to get your basic needs met. Everything else is a want above that. And if you're happy with the needs being met, and you don't have as much desires and wants, again, does this sound like Buddhism? It's very similar, right? Very similar Eastern philosophy, because it's very, very much the same concept. But if you can stop desiring things, if you can stop wanting all these things, and you just be content with the basics of nature provides, you're going to be fucking wealthy. Like, you're going to be wealthy because you're going to be contented, right? And then everything will be gravy, like I said before. Number 11, it is the superfluous things for which men sweat, and the superfluous things that wear our togas threadbare, that force us to grow old in camp, that dash us upon foreign shores. That which is enough is ready to our hands. He who has made a fair compact with poverty is rich. Farewell. So he's ending it basically saying what we said here. Again, superfluous stuff. Everything else besides that, that's the thing that you're going to have to, like, you don't like your boss, you don't like your job, you don't like, you know, kissing up and sucking up and like doing some shit work that you don't want to do. You don't like, you know, all this kind of obligations that you have in life, right? That you don't like your life. The reason for it is because you are trying to gain these superfluous things, right? If you didn't care, if you're just like, you know, there's a lot of homeless people where I'm at here in San Diego. And I mean, a lot of them are crazy, and I'm sure they're not living great lives, but they don't have any fucking, they have no boss, no one to tell. They just do whatever the fuck they want to. Sleep here, shit here, whatever. Because they're getting the food from the trash can, or they're begging for food, right? Like, they're able to, like, sustain themselves. Again, I'm not saying that you should become homeless, but I'm just saying that, like, you've made a choice to obligate, to indebt yourself, to put yourself into slavery, right? And just recognize that that's a choice, right? So if you don't like the shit, right? I mean, it'd be better to live your life and be, quote, poor in other people's eyes, but to be able to have the freedom to do what you want. I've got also a really good series on freedom if you're interested. It's my highest value in life. It's something that I strive for. But check that out, and make sure that you check out the rest of the videos on this playlist. We'll do letter 5 in the next video. Click the subscribe button so you don't miss any of these videos. And also, if you click the bell to get the notifications, you won't miss these when they come out, because I produce a lot of videos. You're going to want to make sure that you don't miss any of these letters from Seneca to Lucilius. And I will talk to you next time. Take care.